Hello, and thank you very much for organizing this conference and for the invitation. So I should say a few words at first. This is a work in progress. It's a new book project. I'm also working on a book about St. Petersburg, about the space and time in this post-Soviet, post-communist metropolis, but that one is kind of on the back burner right now. This one took over. And as an anthropologist, I've been doing, as a historical anthropologist in this case, I've been doing some archival research, like many of you do, but also ethnographic research among the scientists of this lab, and also scientists who worked in Bulgaria with Dimitrov's body and so forth. And the project which I'm writing, the book which I'm writing, will span from the period from the early 1920s until today, because the debates about Lenin's body are alive and very dynamic at the moment, and they tell us a lot about the meaning of the body as well. Okay, so this is called Retouching the Sovereign, Biochemistry of Perpetual Leninism. What kind of a body is lying in the mausoleum in Moscow? Is this the real body of Lenin, an artificial model, or a combination of the two? Rumors about its fake nature have circulated from the beginning. In the first days after Lenin's death in January 1924, his body lay in state in the House of the Unions in Moscow, where enormous crowds gathered to bid farewell to the leader. Poet Vera Ibner, standing in the endless line slowly filing past the body, was reminded of the crowds that gathered in the Panopticon Museum in St. Petersburg a few years previously to see a wax effigy of the Egyptian Empress Cleopatra. In a reenactment of Cleopatra's death, every several minutes a snake slithered out and bit her exposed breast. When Lenin's embalmed body was publicly displayed in the mausoleum in late summer 1924, Moscow was again awash with rumors that the body was made of wax. In the atmosphere of widespread denunciations in the mid-1930s, a young woman reported to the secret police that her acquaintances, the sister and daughter of the once powerful Felix Dzerzhinsky, said in a private conversation that, quote, the body lying in the mausoleum is a wax dummy. These speculations were regularly repeated in Western media. To dispel them, in the 1930s, the party invited a group of Western newsmen to visit the mausoleum. An American journalist, Louis Fisher, wrote that Boris Barsky, one of Lenin's two original embalmers, quote, opened the hermetically sealed glass case, tweaked Lenin's nose, and turned his head to the right and left. It was not wax, it was Lenin. These rumors persisted because they seemed believable. Why bother with the complex science of maintaining Lenin's body if creating its perfect wax replica would do the trick? Besides, drawing a line between real bodies and artificial replicas is not always easy. Internal liquids in the cells of Eva Peron's body have been indeed substituted with wax, prompting her embalmers to nickname her body a candle. Despite a popular assumption, the body of Jeremy Bentham in University College London is mostly artificial. Bentham's skeleton is real, but the flesh around it is made of straw. Bentham's head is a replica to his real head, shriveled beyond recognition, and is preserved in a separate box. When Mao died in 1976, a group of Chinese medics was unexpectedly charged with the task of preserving the chairman's body. Mao famously said many times that he wanted to be cremated because a communist shouldn't take very much space in the ground. But at first they wanted to cremate it, but on the third day after his death, it was decided by a special meeting of the Politburo that he will be preserved. Having no experience in the matter and unable to turn for advice to the more experienced Soviet scientists, at the time the Sino-Soviet relations were at their worst, the Chinese had to experiment. As a backup, it was decided to create a wax replica of Mao's body. Beijing Institute of Arts and Crafts dispatched two specialists to Madame Tussauds Museum in London to learn the newest methods of wax modeling. With surprise and satisfaction, they telegraphed back to Beijing that, quote, in this technique at least, China is already far more advanced than England. In 1977, both bodies of Mao, real and waxen, were transferred to the mausoleum on Tiananmen Square, where they are now. Which one of the two is on display at any given moment depends on whether Mao's real body is scheduled to undergo maintenance. After the Soviet collapse, rumors that Lenin's body is fake resurfaced and grew exponentially. Reacting to this surge, Ilya Zbarsky, son of the original embalmer and himself a longtime expert of Lenin's lab, wrote, quote, "I worked in the mausoleum for 18 years, and I know for a fact that Lenin's body is in a very good condition. All sorts of rumors and fabrications which claim that it is not a real body, but an effigy, or that Lenin's face and hands are successfully preserved, or that only Lenin's face and hands are successfully preserved, have no foundation in reality," unquote. This statement didn't stop the rumors. In the late 1990s, newspapers claimed again that allegedly there were several bodies of Lenin's doubles that were used to substitute for his real body in the mausoleum. And another expert reacted to this claim, Professor Yuri Ramakov, at that time deputy director of Lenin Lab in Moscow, explained in a radio interview on Echo Moskvy in 2000 that Lenin's body was still his own and required no substitutes. In 2008, Vladimir Medinsky, then a Duma deputy and now Russia's Minister of Culture, again announced that Lenin's body was not real, alluding to the fact that most of Lenin's internal organs and liquids were indeed gone, he said, quote, "Do not fool yourselves with the illusion that what is lying in the mausoleum is Lenin. What's left there is only 10% of his body." The respected political weekly Vlast responded with its own half-ironic calculation, concluding that the Duma deputy got it wrong. What's lying in the mausoleum is 23% of Lenin's body, not 10% as he suggested. If we looked closely at the material condition of Lenin's body today, we would see that such rumors are not unfounded. The scientists of Lenin's lab have always focused on preserving the dynamic form, at least I call it dynamic form of Lenin's body, its shape, color, weight, firmness, suppleness of its skin, flexibility of its joints. Even today, the joints of Lenin's body can bend, its torso and neck can rotate, its back and thighs remain supple, its skin is firm and elastic, the hair on its chest and head is attached to the skin, and all of its bodily textures are firm, moist, and flexible. However, to achieve this remarkable feat, Lenin Lab has been gradually substituting this body's original biological matter with new artificial materials. In Soviet times, special commissions of the party leadership and scientists periodically studied Lenin's body in naked state, examining spots on its surface, the suppleness of its skin, the flexibility of the joints, and so forth. To this political scientific gaze of the state, Lenin's body always appeared as flexible, evolving, sometimes improving with time. But to regular visitors to the mausoleum, the body always looked static, fixed in some distant past, preserved once and for all. Visitors saw Lenin lying in a glass sarcophagus, dressed in a dark suit, with only his head and hands exposed. They never saw unexposed parts of the body, never heard of their condition or of the scientific procedures to which the body as a whole has been subjected. The existence of these two distinct regimes of visibility, one for the gaze of the political leadership and scientists, and the other for common citizens, suggests that the political role of Lenin's body always exceeded that of a propaganda symbol designed to boost popular support for the Bolshevik project. To understand this political role, we must first return to the period just before Lenin's death. In spring 1922, Lenin felt ill and exhausted, and on the encouragement of this central committee of the party, left Moscow for the country's estate of Gorky. He rested under the supervision of doctors, but continued to lead the party and make occasional appearances in Moscow. But after his first stroke in May 1922, he temporarily lost ability to speak, read, and write, and the party leadership introduced stricter rules, isolating him from political life. Here's my glass. The new rules reflected a real concern for Lenin's health, but were also designed to neutralize a powerful political rival. In June 1922, a secretary of the Central Committee complained in a letter to a friend that Dzerzhinsky and Smidovich, quote, "guard Lenin like two bulldogs, not letting anyone come close to him or even into the building where he is staying," unquote. In the next year and a half, Lenin's condition worsened, then improved, then worsened again. In spring 1923, after the third stroke, he almost completely lost the ability to communicate, while the political rivalry in the leadership intensified. Lenin didn't simply disappear from public view, but rather his public presence now acquired a new form. While the living and ailing Lenin was isolated in the Gorky estate, A newly constructed canonized image of Lenin started to dominate the political language. Most of the mythologized images and institutions around Lenin's cult that became familiar to all during the Soviet history were created in those final months of his life and in spite of his active protestations. In early 1923, the term Leninism was introduced into public circulation, and rituals of pledging allegiance to Leninism were introduced into party practice. In March 1923, Lenin Institute was established in Moscow. Much of what Lenin was saying and writing after the fall of 1922 was now actively banished from his canonized image. At the same time, the newspaper Pravda appealed to its readers to send, quote, every scrap of paper bearing an inscription or mark made by Lenin to Lenin Institute. Lenin, the political figure, was now doubled into one Lenin who was banished from political life and another Lenin that was canonized within it. In these two simultaneous processes, the banishment and canonization, in the early 1920s, the doctrine of Leninism was born. Every Soviet leader, from Stalin to Gorbachev, produced his own version of Leninism, suppressing, reintroducing, or reinterpreting different aspects of Lenin's legacy. In 1990, less than 2 years before the Soviet state collapsed, the Communist Party admitted that all previous versions of Leninism contained distortions of Lenin's work. Writing in the Central Daily in 1990, a professor of Marxist-Leninist philosophy lamented, quote, our tragedy is that we do not know Lenin. We never read his original texts in the past, and we still do not do this today. It refers to what Igor was talking about yesterday, actually. For decades, we have perceived Lenin through mediators, interpreters, popularizers, and other distorters, the fact that they don't read Lenin. A historian wrote in a widely circulating daily that Khrushchev and Brezhnev, quote, were obviously not Leninists. For them, Lenin was only an icon behind which they could hide. Another historian complained in 1990 that even the Institute of Marxism-Leninism, the country's leading authority on Lenin's theoretical legacy, quote, for 70 years since its foundation has been fulfilling an absurd function, legitimating for publication those Lenin's texts that matched the canon of the day, however different from real Lenin's words they were, and altering or modifying those Lenin's texts that didn't fit the canon, unquote. In his speech on the occasion of Lenin's 120th anniversary in April 1990, Gorbachev said, quote, Lenin still remains with us as the greatest thinker of the 20th century. But then he quickly added, we must rethink Lenin and his theoretical and political work, and we must rid ourselves of the distortions and canonizations of his conclusions. Gorbachev concluded his speech with a blasphemous suggestion. Time has come, he said, to abandon the concept of Leninism altogether, because it reduces Lenin's thought, complex thought, to a collection of canonized statements. When Lenin died on January 21st, 1924, no plans to preserve his body existed. Professor Abrikosov conducted an autopsy and performed short-term embalming that would allow Lenin's body to be displayed in an open coffin for 5 days after the public farewell. The incisions that Abrikosov made in the body cut across major arteries and blood vessels. Later, Abrikosov admitted that had the plans to preserve Lenin's body for posterity existed at the time of the autopsy, he would not have cut these arteries and blood vessels, because in long-term preservation, they are used to deliver embalming liquids to all corners of the body. Lenin lay in state in the House of Trade Unions in Moscow, with huge crowds waiting in extremely cold weather to bid farewell to the leader. It was announced that Lenin would be buried in Moscow on January 27th in a newly built mausoleum on the Red Square near the tomb of fallen revolutionaries. Due to cold temperatures, the body lying in the mausoleum in an open sarcophagus showed no signs of decay for the next 2 months. But in late March, the weather got warmer and the first threatening signs of decomposition were noticed. The extended period of 2 months, during which the body remained in an open sarcophagus, allowed the party leadership to discuss it and consult the scientists about it again and again in endless meetings. It was then that the decision that the body might be preserved and displayed for posterity gradually emerged and won over. At first, many party leaders considered this idea counter-revolutionary. Trotsky, Bukharin, and Voroshilov argued that preserving Lenin's body would be akin to creating a religious relic, an act that violated Marxist-Leninist principles. Bonchpruevich stressed that while it was important to create a public memorial for Lenin, his body should be buried in a closed tomb. But others considered it important to display Lenin's body for a while longer, perhaps even indefinitely, allowing more people from all over the world to pay their respects. Concluding this decisive meeting on the of the leadership on March 5th, 1924, Avil Yunukidze, member of the Central Executive Committee, said, quote, "The body should be preserved and displayed, but without promising to anyone that this is done for posterity. If it doesn't hold up for a period of time, we will have to enclose it," unquote. In late March, it was decided to try an experimental embalming procedure proposed by Professor of Medicine Vladimir Vorobyov and biochemist Boris Zbarsky. Neither of them was certain of success. Vorobyov and Zbarsky worked for 4 months and in late July 1924 reported to the leadership that provided Lenin's body was regularly re-embalmed according to the dynamic method that they developed, it could be preserved for quite some time. They didn't specify for how long. Following their success, on July 24th, 1924, the Commission for the Immortalization of Lenin's Memory issued a public statement. Quote, "We didn't want to turn Lenin's body into some kind of relic by means of which we would popularize or preserve his memory. He had already immortalized himself enough with his brilliant teaching and revolutionary activities. What we wanted is to preserve the body of Vladimir Ilyich because it is of great importance to preserve the physical look, physический oblik, of this remarkable leader for the next generation and all the future generations." These long debates about the fate of Lenin's body and the retrospective statement which I just read about the decision to preserve it suggest that the party leadership saw this body in two distinct ways. This duality is reminiscent of how they treated Lenin in the final months of his life, when the flesh and blood Lenin was banished from political life, while the newly constructed Lenin of Leninism was canonized within it. Lenin's body was now treated in this dual way too. It was officially buried, but continued to be displayed. It was preserved for an indefinite future, but not simply to popularize the memory of a concrete individual. It was the corpse of a person, but its matter transcended individual biology. While this was the body of Lenin, it was also the embodiment of something that was different from Lenin and bigger than him. This way of treating Lenin's body in 1924 is strikingly similar to how the lab scientists have thought about their work since and how they talk about it today. Academician, this is the lab, entrance to the lab, and I couldn't take too many pictures inside, but this is academician Lopukhin on the right. For several decades, the leading scientist of the lab prefers to call Lenin's body life sculpture, живая скульптура. The phrase life sculpture sounds contradictory, which points to a number of ambiguities associated with this body that such terms as corpse, mummy, or relic cannot capture. After decades of being re-embalmed and resculpted, the original biological composition of Lenin's body has changed so considerably, Lopukhin tells me, that in some way it is closer to a representation of Lenin's body than to the body itself. At the same time, Lopukhin stresses, this is not an external representation, as in sculpture or painting, but undeniably the actual body itself. So the phrase life sculpture is designed to capture this ambiguity, referring to a body that both is and is not a representation, as if to say that this is a sculpture of the body that is constructed out of the body itself. In fact, adds Lopukhin, the term sculpture doesn't quite satisfy him either, because it suggests a stiff and hard body, while Lenin's body is supple and flexible. To maintain the material form and dynamic properties of this body, continues Lopukhin, quote, one must not only know the basics of anatomy, physical chemistry, or how to maintain the water balance, one must also possess an artistic sense. This is why not everyone is capable of doing this work. Professor Vratislav Kozeltsov, the other one, another veteran of the lab, makes a similar point, quote, every new wrinkle, cavity, or protrusion in the body must be fixed. We're talking about tiny dimensions. Some amount of artificial substitutes has to be introduced, which is quite difficult. One needs experience and artistic sense to perform this work, unquote. On January 19th, 1939, the Commission of the People's Commissariat of Health for the examination of Lenin's body reported that Lenin's nose, which lost its original form when Lenin's corpse was exposed to extreme cold after death when he was carried from Gorky to the station, train station, was now finally rebuilt in a very good condition. The commission also pointed out that the elasticity of the eyelids had been reconstructed, and the face, quote, makes a complete impression of a sleeping person rather than a corpse. But there were also problems that needed attention. Professor Nikolai Bordenko found new spots, quote, on the outer side of the left forearm and on the lower part of the body, especially in the pelvic area. Alexei Busalov, director of the medical administration of Kremlin, remarked that, quote, on the soles and toes there are some signs of mummification. In the pelvic area there are hints of wrinkling and thinning of the skin. These defects needed to be fixed. One reason for the development of new wrinkles, cavities, and spots in a dead body, which is preserved for a long time, is hydrolysis. Hydrolysis is the process in which solid fats in tissues liquefy and therefore move away from their original area, creating cavities and wrinkles. To solve this problem, the lab developed an artificial material that had the same consistency, softness, and firmness as human fats, but was chemically neutral and therefore didn't liquefy, didn't undergo hydrolysis. In November 1943, Zbarsky explained to a party commission, quote, after many experiments, we developed a mix of paraffin, glycerin, and carotene with a melting point of 57 degrees Celsius. This mix in liquefied form can be injected under skin, where it quickly hardens under room temperature into solid mass that can be easily shaped and sculpted. From the chemical point of view, this mass is inert and can be preserved without change, unquote. The material was applied by micro-injections to the parts where, quote, depression or change of volume was discovered, substituting for the fatty materials that underwent hydrolysis, unquote. Georgi Mityarev, People's Commissar of Health, asked Zbarsky, quote, so you insert artificial mass, does this mean that after a period of time, all fats in the body will be replaced with this new artificial mass? Zbarsky replied positively, and Mityarev was satisfied. From the Commission's point of view, it seems, substituting original biomatter with artificial materials was not a problem, as long as it helped maintaining this dynamic form of the body, the shape, volume, elasticity, flexibility, smoothness. Why maintaining the flexible body form was more important than preserving the body's authentic biomatter? Why did the scientists labor so hard on maintaining the dynamic parameters of the body form, even in the parts that were not meant for public display? What was the political significance of this work? We may be able to answer these questions if we compare this body with the bodies of political leaders in different cultural and historical contexts. Western European kings, famously analyzed by Kantorovich, are a useful point of departure. Kantorovich traced the late medieval and early modern legal theories that linked monarchic sovereignty with the king's body. Sovereign power is absolute not only spatially, but also temporally, because it has the capacity of reproducing perpetually, surviving the demise of every concrete agent of sovereignty. But in what material form is temporal perpetuity invested? When this question became important for political and theological reasons in late medieval England and France, it led to the development of a legal doctrine of the king's two bodies. With the shift towards the new secularized model of monarchy between the 14th and 16th centuries, the king's legitimacy could no longer be based solely in the approval and consecration by the church, and instead became purely dynastic, legitimized purely by biological lineage, that is, coming not from grace but from nature. Royal qualities and potencies, writes Kantorovich, were now seen as natural traits that dwelt directly in the king's blood, creating a royal species of man. According to this view, the physical body of the king, unlike that of regular mortals, was doubled, consisting of two bodies that coexisted within one flesh, the mortal body, or body of nature, and the immortal body, or body of grace. The king's death was the demise of his mortal body, while the immortal body survived and re-inhabited the flesh of the next king. During the interregnum, the doubling of the monarch's body acquired an explicitly material manifestation, which came to be reflected in the construction of the monarch's effigy. The effigy looked uncannily similar to the deceased king, but was different from his or her external representation. While sculptures and images of the dead are common in many funeral ceremonies around the world, they usually function as representations of the dead person, that is, as a substitute for the missing corpse. But the role played by the effigy was different. It appeared only for a short period of time before and during the funeral, always coexisting with the display of the monarch's corpse instead of substituting for it. the pair of the corpse and the effigy functioned as the actual material doubling of the monarch's body. These are some effigies which were preserved in the Westminster Abbey. An effigy looked like an exact healthy version of the monarch. It was made of waxed leather and wood. Its face was modeled on the monarch's death mask and carefully painted to look as alive as possible. Real hair was used, artificial eyelids were inserted. Limbs were created with moving joints. It was dressed in the monarch's clothes and seated on the throne. Medics sometimes pretended to take its pulse and listen to its breath. It was served food and wine after meals, and its mouth and hands were wiped. Sometimes even courtiers mistook the effigy for the real king. During the funeral procession, both the monarch's corpse and the effigy were carried through the city. With the coronation of the next monarch, the corpse of the previous monarch was buried and the effigy was destroyed or hidden in the cellar or in a distant monastery. That's how this one survived. Now the mortal and immortal bodies of the sovereign were again reunited within one person, and so the effigy could not be displayed anymore. For Kantarovich, the theory of the king's two bodies was an artifact of the late medieval, early modern Christian Western Europe. However, anthropologists and historians have described many comparable rituals of the perpetual regeneration of sovereign power in diverse socio-cultural and historical contexts. The third edition of Sir James Fraser's The Golden Bow, a study in comparative religion, which was published in 1916, anthropologist James Fraser, describes the rituals of royal succession of the Shuluk kingdom of southern Sudan, which in some detail, including the ritual of doubling the royal body and using a wooden effigy, are uncannily reminiscent of those described by Kantarovich. Comparable cosmologies and rituals developed in other parts of the world, from East India to pre-modern Japan, from ancient imperial Rome to modern Vatican. It appears that the temporal conflict between the impermanence of the sovereign human's body and the permanence of the sovereign office, and an attempt to avoid a crisis of power as a result of this discordance, led to the emergence of a comparable cosmologies and rituals that involved bodily doubling in many diverse contexts. The case explored by Kantarovich, therefore, appears to be a significant but culturally and historically specific variety of a broader phenomenon. In the Leninist system, a distinct political cosmology that linked a doubling of the foundational body with the sovereignty of the political regime had also emerged. It's important to stress that this is not an argument about direct causality. The particular structure of Leninist sovereignty developed not as a direct transformation of sovereign principles that existed earlier in the Russian monarchy or in the institutions and practices of the Orthodox Church. In fact, as Michael Chernyavsky, a student of Kantarovich, argued, the doctrine comparable to that of the king's two bodies in France and England never developed in the Russian Tsarist state. However, in the Soviet Leninist polity, the perpetual dimension of sovereignty became manifested materially in the form that included a doubling of the foundational body. The importance of this kind of political imaginary for the Bolshevik state emerged gradually when a few contingent circumstances coincided. The relatively long public presence of the unburied body in the months after Lenin's death, the growing dissociation of Lenin from Leninism that was constructed in his absence, the peculiar combination of a modern revolutionary ethos and a traditional form of power that came to define the party state after the 1920s. To clarify these points, I will first compare and contrast the form of power in the Bolshevik state with that in the absolutist monarchy and then in modern liberal democracy. In the absolutist monarchies of Europe, of the European Ancien Regime, the legitimacy of the sovereign was guaranteed by his or her link to another place, a place that was external to the political world of the monarchy, where the immortal, timeless truth was anchored. The physical body of each ruling monarch in that system occupied that external other place. That is, the monarch existed outside of the political space of the state. In contemporary liberal democracy, as demonstrated by Claude Lefort, the center of sovereign power is also anchored in another place. But not now that place is empty. Democratic rulers, unlike absolutist monarchs, cannot occupy that place, but they must act in the name of that place and refer to it for legitimacy. It's like the Founding Fathers in America, for example, that text. It is in that other place that the foundational truth of a liberal democracy is anchored. Eric Santner, a political philosopher from Chicago, also recently argued that in liberal democracy, with the disappearance of the king's body, the locus of sovereignty migrated into a new location. But unlike Lefort, he defines that new location as a collective body of the people, or the population, nation. Taken together, Lefort's and Santner's arguments, even though they sound contradictory at first, actually, if they are taken together, they describe precisely the doubling of the sovereign body in modern liberal democracy. This body is split between the mortal, perpetually reproduced body of the population and the immortal body of this foundational truth that is located in another place. In the Soviet Leninist polity, the structure of sovereign power had many features that were similar to those in absolutist monarchy and liberal democracy, but also quite different from both. Unlike an absolutist monarch, no acting Soviet leader after Lenin could occupy that other place where sovereign power was anchored. That place was occupied by the embodied figure of Leninism. Any Soviet leader, including Stalin, at the height of his powers, had to refer to Leninism for legitimacy and could not question or transcend it. And any leader could be instantly delegitimized if they were shown to violate Leninism. The emergence of Stalin's extraordinary cult of personality and power, and the collapse of that cult after his death, which did not lead to the collapse of the party, illustrate this point well. Stalin's rise and fall were both connected to Leninism. At first, he was celebrated as the most faithful Leninist who had unique access to the foundational truth. And after his death, he was accused of precisely the opposite, of having distorted the foundational truth. Therefore, Stalin didn't and could not occupy the center of sovereign power. But what was the figure that occupied that center? I said it was embodied Leninism, but maybe we can be more precise. Ken Jowett makes, another political theorist, makes a somewhat different comparison, allowing us to push this analysis further. He argues that in the Leninist system, sovereign power was centered neither in the traditional charismatic leader, as it was in the absolutist monarchy or in the Nazi state, nor in the depersonalized modern bureaucracy as in liberal democracies, but in a unique new institution that looked like a combination of the two, peculiarly. This new political institution was the Leninist Party, the party of the new type, which Jowett calls neo-traditional, because it emerged when two seemingly incompatible principles were absorbed into one organizational structure, the traditional principle of individual heroism and the modern principle of organizational impersonalism. So both Leninist and Nazi political systems, for example, emphasized a heroic ethic. However, what agent each system designated as heroic was different. In the Nazi state, that heroic agent was the individual charismatic leader, Führer. Nazism was based on Führer principle, the personal charisma of the leader who claims authority because he incorporates the idea in his person. In the Leninist system, the heroic agent was not individual, but the party. Its heroism was defined in organizational, not individual terms. The party's principle of organization, therefore, Jowett suggests, is charismatic impersonalism. Jowett's discussion helps us to clarify how the structure of Lenin's sovereign power worked. The center of sovereignty in this case was located neither in the body of the charismatic leader, as in the monarchy or in another state, nor in the split between empty space and collective body of the population, as in the liberal democracy, but in the combination of the two, in the collective impersonal charismatic subject known as the Leninist Party. Everyone could be accused of crimes, everyone could be purged, including the general secretary, but the party couldn't. It was always already correct. This discussion makes it clear what political role the preserved body of Lenin played in this system of power. This body, or rather the form of this body, as I was saying, not the matter, functioned as the material embodiment of a particular kind of sovereign, the charismatic impersonal subject of the Leninist Party. As the embodiment of that sovereign, Lenin's body was doubled, functioning as a combination of a mortal body and an immortal body. This is why Lenin's body was always maintained as a combination of a corpse, mortal body, which was shown for the population, and an effigy, immortal body, which is constantly studied by this commissions. The term life sculpture that academician Lopukhin uses to refer to this body is designed to describe precisely this internal doubling, a body that exists as a combination of immortal and immortal bodies. Indeed, Lenin's body is mortal at the level of his biological matter. This is a corpse whose biological remains decay and are gradually substituted with new artificial materials. And Lenin's body is also immortal at the level of its dynamic form. This is like an effigy whose form is carefully reconstructed again and again to remain continuously the same. In all periods of Soviet history, reproducing Leninism as the foundational truth of the communist project amounted to re-editing and reinterpreting Lenin's texts, therefore changing their meanings, and reconstructing and re-embalming his body while changing its constitutive biomatter. Every 1.5 years, Lenin's body is subjected to big procedures that last... there's another picture of the still effigies. Big procedures that last 2 months. All embalming liquids are drained from Lenin's body and subjected to a variety of tests to identify various biological and chemical processes that develop in the body. Samples of different tissues are collected and tested. The body is submerged for weeks in baths with different embalming solutions. Hundreds of micro photographs of its surface are taken and compared with the photographs taken previously. Artificial substances are injected to reconstruct the landscape of skin and the skin pressure of its surfaces. Plastics and other materials are applied to reconstitute the original volume of body parts, the flexibility of joints, skin color, overall weight, and so forth. All these concerns not only head and hands, as I was saying, but the whole body, which the public can never see. In this process, the dynamic form of the body is reconstructed, while its biological matter changes. This work has led to the emergence of a unique kind of science with its unusual discoveries and inventions, instruments and procedures, classified dissertations and classified journals. However, some innovations of that science have actually entered regular medicine and even found their way into Western medical practice. In the 1960s, Yuri Lopukhin, whom I showed earlier, and his team worked on a new method and new instruments for perfusion, that is, maintaining the form and volume of a tissue or an organ by flowing liquids through the capillary system. Perfusion is also used in regular medicine, for example, to maintain organs of recently deceased persons outside of the body in preparation for organ transplantation. Several instruments and designs that Lopukhin's team developed in Lenin Lab, he later adapted for his work on kidney transplantation in living patients. All these key scientists have two appointments. They work in the lab and they also have a position in different research institutes in Moscow which do other work, which is why that cross-pollination can happen. Professor Kozeltsov, whom I've shown, explains to me, quote, during the procedure of re-embalming, it is crucial that the anatomical image, that is volume, dynamic characteristics of tissues, are preserved absolutely intact. It is important to maintain precise volume. To put it simply, no tissue should swell or shrink when liquids are added or drained. When Lopukhin worked on this challenging task, he arrived at a very interesting solution, which he later applied to his work on kidney transplantation. A kidney is an appropriate organ for this because it is relatively isolated inside the body, like a separate vessel with an input and an output of liquids. Having developed a complex set of instruments that enabled perfusion of different tissues, Lopukhin later applied it to maintaining a life and volume of a kidney outside the body. The first set of instruments, приборное оформление, they call it, he designed here in the lab. In 1969, for this work on kidney transplantation, Lopukhin was awarded the State Prize of the USSR. An important requirement for work on the body is that new cuts and punctures of the skin should be avoided. Since the lab has been frequently testing the internal composition of the epidermis, which is the outside layers of skin, to avoid avoiding cutting was very important, and therefore they developed different non-invasive testing methods. In 1986, Lopukhin and his colleague Adrianov at the Research Institute of Physico-Chemical Medicine, where he was also appointed, Lopukhin, adapted this method for non-invasive measurements of cholesterol levels in the skin of living patients. The method is known as a three-drop test. It involves putting a drop of a liquid agent on the surface of the palm. It enters into reaction with the underskin cholesterol, extracting it to the surface of the skin. Then a drop of another solution is applied to the same spot. This solution changes the color in the presence of cholesterol. In fact, not one, but three drops are applied, each with different concentration of the solution, and each changing color differently. The concentration is chosen in such a way that in a healthy person, only one drop of the solution will change color. In a person who is in the risk group with relatively high cholesterol, two drops will change color. And in the person who is in the very high risk of a heart disease with high cholesterol, all three will change color. This is why, and this is a very simple test which one can do at home because it's non-invasive, there's no injections and so forth. This method is possible because about 11% of the overall body cholesterol is contained in the skin, and it's a pretty precise number. The test can be conducted at home, as I said. In 1992, Lopuhin and his colleagues described the three-drop test in an English language publication, and in 2002 they received the US patent for this method. The patent was purchased by Toronto-based medical device company IMI, International Medical Innovations, that was later renamed PreMD. Using the three-drop method, PreMD, together with a Winnipeg-based medical diagnostic company, Miraculins, developed a simple non-invasive diagnostic test for cholesterol known as Preview test. Today, it is marketed in Canada, Europe, and the United States as the world's first and only non-invasive skin cholesterol test. However, its promotional materials do not mention its origin in Lenin's body. In her study of Lenin's cult, historian Nina Tumarkin suggested that the Bolshevik leadership preserved Lenin's body to create a sacred relic that would continue to legitimate Soviet power and mobilize the population that was deeply orthodox, largely illiterate, and invested in saints and clerics. Relics. It has been also suggested that the decision to preserve Lenin's body was influenced by Nikolai Fyodorov's philosophy of common cause that sought human salvation and the physical resurrection of the flesh. If these ideas influenced the decision in any way, they couldn't have been decisive. The problem with these arguments is that they focus on the symbolic analysis of Lenin's body without paying any attention to its actual material composition and the scientific procedures to which it has been subjected. In fact, as I have argued, the complex method of preserving Lenin's body amounts to a continuous reconstruction of its form and substitution of its flesh with new artificial substances. What emerges in this process is a kind of quasi-artificial flesh that is quite incompatible with the nature of incorruptible relics or with the remains that Fyodorov sought to resurrect. To understand what the political role of Lenin's body was in the Soviet times, it is important to know its dynamic materiality, the condition of its tissues, cells, and joints, the procedures and tests to which it has been subjected, the scientific knowledge that has developed around it. Lenin's body has played a central role in reproducing Leninist sovereign power. Sovereignty in the Soviet Leninist system was vested neither in the figure of the ruler, as I was saying in the absolutist monarchy, nor in the abstract population as in liberal democracy, but in the collective impersonal agent, this Leninist party. This sovereign agent transcended every one of its members. Each party member, including party leader, could be found to be wrong and illegitimate, but the party as an impersonal agent was always already legitimate and right. Lenin's body was the material embodiment of this impersonal sovereign agent. Regularly reproducing Leninism as the foundational truth of the system involved, as I was saying earlier, manipulating and reinterpreting his texts and facts of his life, and also resculpting his physical body at the level of form while changing its biostructure. In the end, the persistent rumors about Lenin's body being a fake are neither accurate nor wrong. This body is real and yet constructed. Its biomaterial composition is changing, but its dynamic form remains the same. This project emerged gradually as a part of a complex political cosmology that most participants, politicians and scientists, could not necessarily articulate in all of its underlying cultural complexity. The cultivation of Lenin's body in the Soviet period was always performed in strict secrecy, behind closed doors, visible only to the gaze of the political leadership and a small group of scientists. The reason for this secrecy is the same as the reason for making invisible constant manipulations to which Lenin's words, thoughts and facts of his life have been also subjected. This approach allowed for Leninism to appear as the eternal, unchanging, foundational truth, a kind of truth that appeared to be the legitimate source of the party's actions, rather than their product. With the demise of the party, the communist project, and the Soviet polity in 1991, Lenin's body became severed from this complex political and cultural system and lost its original role in the system of sovereignty. The new Russian state neither closed the mausoleum nor paid much attention to it. In the past 25 years, it has deferred any decision on the fate of Lenin's body. Today, this body remains on public display and the lab continues to work. In this context, one thing has become clear. For many scientists of the lab, this project has long constituted a unique scientific experiment. It has created a body that has never been static and fixed, but has been dynamic, changing, emerging, creating an unusual kind of scientific knowledge. The collapse of the Soviet polity didn't automatically spell the end of the embodied momentum invested in this body, but it did not turn the scientific body into a corpse and didn't reduce it to an effigy. Thank you.